Hey, everyone.
That was, yeah, a great presentation from Anna. We at Mighty Kingdom work quite closely with the visual effects industry because there's a lot of crossover in skills and things like that. There might be a lot of repetition of facts here, but I'll try and keep it as specific as possible to games. But I think, you know, hopefully that just speaks to the fact that, you know, there's a lot of very applicable skills within the industry and within, sort of, you know, creative arts in general. There we go. I just want to try and give you a bit of an outline of the industry in Australia and in South Australia. And also at Mighty Kingdom, I think we are the largest independent game company in the country. As such, we tend to employ a lot of people. We've been scaling quite a bit. I think growing the industry is something that we are really passionate about, and a lot of what we, you know, a lot of our initiatives and things are about bringing more people into the industry and creating sort of a sustainable industry for those people. Firstly, a bit about me. As Matt said, I'm the Chief Product Officer at Mighty Kingdom. I grew up in Adelaide. I did my Bachelor of Creative Arts at Flinders Uni. I actually did film. Part of that, it's kind of because the job that I do now didn't exist when I was in high school, and it was sort of only just emerging when I started uni in 2008. That was, I think, I was one of those kids at high school that you've probably got a few in your class who are very passionate about the entertainment that they consume and they want to create and tell stories be large, part of something a bit larger than themselves. So I sort of saw that as the film industry. I ended up coming through to games via marketing. So I was doing sort of films and things with my friends. They had, you know, the internet existed. That was a way of finding an audience and things like that. I was particularly fortunate to meet Phil Mays, our CEO, and find a pathway through that avenue. And when I joined Mighty Kingdom, I was employee number 5. Now we have 88 people in the country, across the country. Most of us are in Adelaide, but I think COVID has sort of given us a bit of a kick up the butt in terms of how much we wanted to become a distributed workforce, and we definitely have ambitions to become an international, have international locations and things like that. This is us currently, sort of most of us. We work on mobile and console games. Where, as I say, we're all across the country. We have a sort of, we put a premium on diversity, which I'll talk about later. I often get asked to talk to high school students directly, and I sort of get asked to repeat my story a little bit as well. I'm always a little, not reluctant to do that, but I try and frame it more around the skills and things that I think have helped me grow in my career, because I feel like I think about my journey and it's not replicable for your students or anyone. Like a lot of it had to do with luck. A lot of it had to do with where the industry was at that time. So I really want to try and, whenever I do things like this, I try and put a premium on like what it is that what I think helped me, and then what I look for when I'm mentoring other students now and things like that. In terms of Mighty Kingdom, though, we are kind of, I guess, we're sort of a work-for-hire studio, moving, I guess, into a transition period where we're also working on licenses and developing our own original IP. So we are working across anywhere between 5 and 7 projects at a time at the studio. We want to work with the top entertainment companies in the world with that. We feel like that gives us an opportunity to learn about, you know, what it is that makes those companies so great and their brands and things like that. We have a focus on, I guess, what we would call underserved markets. So I guess with the exception of Conan Chop Chop there, we tend to think of our audience as tween and middle-aged women. So part of that, I mean, you might have heard these expressions before, but 46% of the US gaming audience is female, but nowhere near 46% of the content is made for females. So we try and, you know, we see that not only as an opportunity in market, but it's also an opportunity to grow the market globally as well. It's, I would say it's kind of not sexy. Like, we get a lot of people coming in, we do a lot of, you know, we have heaps of, as you can probably imagine, work experience requests and things like that. That often is someone who is, they're often young males, and they're often, they're coming at it from a place of passion, which is really great. But I think what we try and do is, I guess, number one, communicate that when you're working on brands, it doesn't matter if you're working on a Star Wars or Shopkins, you're kind of solving the same problems. Game development is game development. Doesn't matter which, like, what the colors on your polygon are, it's kind of the same problems. And also try and, I think, develop empathy within those students. Basically, when you're we have a really strong ethos of developing games for audiences. We're a commercial organization, we need to do that. But that means, you know, stepping outside of yourself and really thinking about, okay, who is the audience and how can I serve them? Anyone who comes into the organization who has an ability to do that or is sort of thinking about that is going to go really far. You know, I still have game designers that I have to call up on that every single day. But, you know, that's a process, and we're sort of looking at broadening our audiences and things like that. But I think there is definitely the expectation. And I found this a lot in film, actually, like the expectation of you come into the industry with a strong sense of what your day-to-day is going to be like, and then you find out what that working creatively in that industry professionally is, and you're like, kind of don't like this. So, but they, you know, they're clinging onto that dream. So I think for us, it's really about, we do a lot of work to try and, you know, communicate those expectations really early, and a lot that starts with thinking about creating for someone else, as opposed to, like, what's your great idea? Tell us your, you know, people have that, the dream of going in there and being like, I've got the best idea for a game ever. And they might, but then, you know, is there an audience for it? Is that something that we're well placed to execute on? All of those questions. Sometimes that's a really hard journey to take people on, sometimes it's not. But the people who are able to understand that and work towards that go really far. I don't know if this will work, but it is our trailer for Avis Manor, which is, no, it's not going to work, sorry. If you search for Avis Manor on the App Store or Google Play now, you'll see the probably our flagship product. Follows Ava, a lovelorn mystery writer who inherits a manor, and you play games of solitaire and also help her renovate the manor and solve the mystery of her family. That'll give you an idea of the kind of things that we work on and who our core audience is. So we do all of the, we work with a company in Canada to do that. We do all of the art, character design, story, all of that kind of stuff. And they do the solitaire. So that's a lot of what our team is working on at the moment. It's the kind of, yeah, as I say, the kind of stuff that we're working on. And we as a company, oh no, it's
going to
work.
Isn't going to plan. Come on, Ava. You're a mystery writer. Why can't you just write? My fan mail would always bring me joy, but it's mostly bills now. I feel so trapped by writer's block and this crummy apartment. Poor Marlo does too. Probably another bill. I guess I should take care of those. This doesn't seem like a bill or fan mail. My long-lost relative left me their sprawling estate? And a one-way plane ticket to Europe? Serena warned me it was too good to be true, but I had hope. All I knew was that I needed a big change, so I packed my bags and set off with Marlo on a new chapter.
So yeah, that's some of, I guess, the prelude to Ava's Manor. So we have, as a company, have a goal to create $1 billion IP in Australia, which sounds hard, and it is, but it's also, you know, there's new entrants in that space all the time, and we feel like we have a really strong idea of what that's going to require, and it's going to require a lot of talented people. So we're very much invested in developing those talents and finding those talents early. So just, I guess, to speak more about the global industry. So in Australia, you know, we're very much, as I say, a global industry, but we have kind of existed as very much an island for a while, in the sense that we are pretty insular in the economy, in the industry. For a long time, we were seen as an outsource location for large studios. So a lot of my colleagues who have been in the industry for a lot longer worked at companies like Chrome Studios that were working on Lucasfilm properties, working with WB properties, things like that. During the global financial crisis, all of that money left. A lot of those studios closed. And the smaller studio, or the people who either couldn't or didn't want to leave the country or the industry, stayed and made sort of smaller indie-focused studios. They're kind of burned a little bit by the large companies. So as a result, we tend to have a lot of smaller players who are very focused on the art aspect of the industry and not really focused on sustainability or commercialization. That can make it challenging for us to hire, because it really favours generalists. It's an environment that really favours people who can both code and, you know, write and do art and sound, and can kind of, I guess, be, you know, the sort of one-man band of a studio, or, you know, three or four people doing all of the jobs. These days, we're at a point at Mighty Kingdom where we're scaling and we actually need specialists in areas. But that being said, when you are a larger company, you have larger roles and different, I guess, a wider variety of skill sets and roles. So, I mean, I am the chief product officer. I haven't opened up Unity, which is our program that we use to actually make games, in years. Our CEO was a programmer. He hasn't written a line of code in years. Our skills are much more geared around business development and things like that, which is definitely lacking in the industry. So there's definitely, yeah, different avenues for people to come into the industry. I work with the Adelaide University to bring in economics students into it, because we have economies in our games and I want them to give us ideas about how we can make those economies better. I guess sort of to illustrate that, this was the makeup of the studio when I started. So we would have a product manager and a game designer, very creative and business-focused roles. Programmers, they would do all the different types of programming within the games. A business development manager who would get us new clients and things like that. Animator, a game artist, and a marketing assistant, which was my role at the time. These days, and as I say, that's sort of the generalization of it. So animators would do 2D and 3D, the artists would do 2D and 3D, and often the UI at the same time. Business development manager did a lot of the actual, you know, a producer would normally do these days. And the programmers would do all of the programming across the game. These days, it looks much like more like this. So we have, I guess, the biggest thing there is, as I say, the specialization of roles, but it's also a lot on the admin, administrative services side. So we have our studio manager, hiring manager, education manager, finance manager, the bookkeeper, IT department, different types of animators and people who, I mean, Anna probably talked about this, like pipeline developers to assist those animators. We have someone who's a full-time music composer internally, which is, you know, probably one of the only roles like that in the country that exists. 2D, 3D artists, concept artists, UI artists, effects artists who also work closely with their pipeline developers, games programmers, QA engineers. That's a really great entry-level role for people who are more generalist but still want to join a large studio. Data scientists, that's one of my biggest challenges at the moment, is finding people who can piece together and interpret and analyze data. That's what our studio runs on, is the data. It tells us what we need to be doing better and what we're doing well, and it helps us measure our output. Producers, product managers, narrative design, all different types of game designers. So there is a really wide berth of skills. People, I think, in the industry who don't have experience or haven't come into the industry through sort of a side door, as I did, tend to come to us via the graduate program. So we run a graduate program every year. It's one of the only ones in the country, so it's very competitive. We average around 250 applicants for around 5 roles. But it is open to anyone who's graduated in the last year from a tertiary institution and has work rights in Australia, so that's also why it's quite large. The thing I would say that, like, in terms of sort of preparing students for that, we do favour people who have done roles related to, have studied things related to the role that they're applying for. So if they've done computer science or something like that and they're applying for a programming role, that's great. If they have done an arts degree and are applying for a programming role, that's not great. There are lots of, I think Anna mentioned AIE, there are lots of institutions that will teach gaming adjacent skill sets as well. So that tends to be the people who get through. And we have people from all over the country applying as well. I think you can see Charlie there in the scarf on the computer. She was stuck in Sydney for a while, unfortunately. But we've brought her down here now. We try and look for, I think when we're looking at the graduate program as well, we're really looking for people who have soft skills. Anna talked about this as well. I cannot emphasize that enough. We really want people with soft skills. To us, that means, you know, people who are engaged and excited about what they're doing, so they go out and they are looking for ways that they can add value and be edited. People who seek feedback. This is the number one piece of advice that I give to high school students. I always say, you know, when you leave high school, you're no longer in an environment where someone is paid to care about your success. So you have to give them a reason to care about your success. And the best way to do that is to seek advice and then act on it. The people who seek advice and act on it are people who go really far at Mighty Kingdom. The desire to learn as well, I think it's, you know, we all thought we knew everything at some point in our lives. But I think that, you know, having the sense of, you know, what it is that you're trying to achieve in, not necessarily in your career. We don't expect people to have a path mapped out for themselves, but to know, okay, basically just curiosity. We want people to understand, to be looking for how they can, to learn more and contribute to teams. Team orientated. I think gaming kind of suffers a little bit because it's one of the few creative endeavors, I guess, as opposed to film, that you can do entirely on your own if you really, really, really wanted to. So you can get away with not working in a team for a while. That can be challenging. Having team orientated skills is really important, and having that mindset. And being execution focused. So this is, for us, this means, like, if someone comes to, if we've got two candidates who are identical, but one of them has, made a small game and finished it and deployed it to the App Store, or done something and created and finished a piece of work, I'm not super interested in how good that work is, but it shows me that they're able to follow through on what they're starting, and they're not just sort of like ideas, that they're actually looking to do every piece of that work. I think we bias towards skills over passion, ultimately, is what I would say. We love people who are interested in the industry and they've got that passion, but I'm not really interested in how much you want it. I want to know what you've done to get there, and what you're, how you're looking to better yourself and learn more about it, as opposed to just loving it, which can be sometimes challenging. I definitely suffered from it a little, I think, early in my career as a filmmaker. The other thing that we are looking to do is basically bring gender parity to the industry as much as we can. I think the most recent industry body survey said there was about 20% women and non-binary people in the industry in Australia and 80% male. In Mighty Kingdom, I think we're about 40-60 female-male. We have a goal to be 50-50 by 2023, I believe. That is going to be really challenging. We've hired basically an HR team to help us get there. I believe really strongly that we're going to have to do a lot of headhunting in terms of for those senior roles, because a lot of women unfortunately leave the industry halfway through their career, either because they're in a male-dominated environment, they're like, this kind of sucks, or they're, in the way that a lot of attrition happens in lots of other industries. I would really encourage, if you have students in your class that are interested in gaming in any form, please direct them to these institutions. So Girl Geek Academy does a lot of holiday workshops and things like that. Code Like a Girl, I think Anna mentioned, they do a lot of sort of, here is someone who, this is a job that exists that you could do if you're interested in this. They also do a lot of workshops. Her Tech Path, they sort of focus on primary age, I believe. They do a lot of great work as well. And Girls in STEM Toolkit on their website has a lot of great, resources around, how you can encourage people in your classes to do that. I'd love if you took a photo of this slide and referred back to it later. So we also, I think in terms of, I heard Anna talking about this as well, in terms of like how early we bring people into the company. Previously we would do things like school tours and stuff like that. We sort of stopped that recently just because of non-disclosure agreements, things that we're working on. As we got bigger, it was harder to kind of funnel people around. We are working on getting that paperwork sorted so that we can get people from all ages in. We were bringing a lot of work experience people in. I think we found that they were kind of... We want them to have a project that they want to work on while they're there, and then have, use our resources to ask questions and things. It's sort of hard for us to just go, do this. We want them to have a goal and an outcome. Again, we have stopped doing that recently because of resources and paperwork. We are working on that. Other than that, it's really our graduate program, and internships are another way of part of getting credit through university. We don't take unpaid internships, but we do want to work with people who are looking to build that into part of their tertiary education. I think for us, we have, as I say, we've scaled a lot recently, so we have kind of not, we've had to leave some of the more primary and high school education initiatives behind us temporarily. We're looking at scaling those up again because we do really feel like, getting kids pre-15 years old is really when we want to be developing those skills, especially for non-male people and sort of getting them into a pathway into industry. I think we have time for questions. We may not, but I'll try and go real fast if we do. I did what I would call a fire hose of information on you guys. It's an industry that I think, you probably have heaps of kids in your class who are really interested in gaming, but it can be really hard to find the information for it. So, here to help. Yeah, we primarily do. Part of that has been just because that's what, like when we're collaborating with people, they're also using that as well. It was the most friendly, because we were a mobile studio for a long time, it was the most mobile friendly product. But that being said, we are starting the conversations to, you know, whenever we're spinning up a new product, we do now have the conversation of, is this an Unreal product? I would definitely encourage your students to be using Unity over Unreal if they want to be deploying, as I say, if they want to be like actually executing on some stuff. I think that's really the way to go, at least to begin with. I think if they have, you know, art, if they've got an art bent to their career and that's really what they're interested in, there's, you know, there's no harm in it. But I think the resources available are so valuable on the Unity side. They do a lot of education outreach and things like that. I think, like, it's kind of, it's a funny one. There's kind of never been an easier time to make a game, but it means that the competition to make games and have a career in games is kind of high, even though there are lots of opportunities now to be in the games industry. So yeah, that's kind of, I guess, why I always hammer skills over passion, because there's a lot of people out there who also love it and they're doing a lot of work to be there as well. No. Yeah, if there's no other questions, definitely Gail has my details. Like hello at Mighty Kingdom also will go to Edwina, our talent manager, and it will, you know, it's good to know if people have questions, we can kind of shape our education initiatives around that as well, based on feedback. So please send it through. Cool.